Hello, everyone. On behalf of Rocio Christi, the College Republicans, the College Democrats, and Summit Ministries, thank you for being at our event tonight. My name is Bailey Gradden, and I'm the president of Rocio Christi at UNCW. I am so honored to be a part of this incredible organization, as they have blessed me by reinventing what I thought a on-campus ministry could be. 1 Peter 3:15 states that as we Christians are instructed to honor the Lord by always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks us for a reason, for the hope that is in us, and doing it with gentleness and respect. I believe that Rocio Christi is doing that as we are not simply edifying Christians in their walk, but helping them to become a community of ambassadors for the faith with the proper reinforcements to go out into the world. Our chapter of Rocio Christi is doing our part each week to fulfill this commission through our Evangelism Tuesday and Worldview Wednesday events. As we give students the opportunity to answer hard questions with love and to minister to the UNCW student body, Rocio meets every Monday here on campus in Fisher from 7 o'clock to 9 as we seek to strive truth and to examine scientific, philosophical, and historical arguments for the existence of Christ. I am so excited to be a part of this event, as my involvement with Rocio stemmed from our other major sponsor tonight, Summit Ministries. I became involved with Summit Ministries as I attended as a student in 2015 and fell in love with the big changes that this ministry was making in high school and college students' lives. I loved it so much that I went back and staffed both summers for 2016 and 2017. Summit helped me to realize that there is so much more than what meets the eye when it comes to Christianity. That blind faith does not make you a more fervent Christian than equipping yourself with concrete knowledge for the existence of God and His Word. Summit gave me the tools that I needed to construct a worldview, and for the first time, I was shown that what I think about Christ is ultimately what shapes my entire outlook in life. The combination of instructional apologetics, the support of my small group leader, the summit staff, the love of community helped me to realize that all the social issues that I was advocating for meant absolutely nothing if it was not for Christ's glory. I will forever be grateful for this life-changing ministry and for the light that it has shown in my lives. And I am even more grateful to be standing here before you today as Rocio's president, thanks to what they have done. And so you can see what I have seen in them. Here is a video.
Before I came to Summit, I was questioning who God was, where He was, what His role still was in my life.
I think it's so hard to find truth and to be able to sit down and sort out like biblical truth, because the world is just so noisy.
Summit's a place where you go not only to see the bigger picture of what God's really doing in this world, but to get a sense of where you fit in that bigger picture. How can you live a bigger story than you ever imagined you would?
One of the most important things for you to do is know what you believe and why.
What does morality mean? Am I valuable? Is there an afterlife?
You get to ask tough questions here. And you get to ask those tough questions of really smart people who have good answers to those tough questions.
Coming to Summit shaped my worldview entirely. I know what I believe, but I had no clue what other people believed.
Talking about the deep things in life, I think, can really pull people together.
Trust builds here quickly because you have the same goal and interests in mind.
And being able to relate to like everyone else's story and tell them like you're not alone in this.
So apologetics is about being confident in the gospel, but also living the gospel.
This is preparing us for the world that we live in now.
2 weeks, amazing speakers, loving mentors, lifelong friendships. Change the trajectory of your life forever, starting summer 2019.
Good evening, everyone. I'm sure you've seen my face a few times already up here. My name is Lexi Forrester, and I'm with Rocio Christi, and I am so grateful that you chose to come out tonight. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what tonight will look like, as well as a little bit about our speakers. But I would like to first say, I don't know if you noticed in this video, but actually one of the speakers who was briefly shown in the video is actually coming to one of our events a month from now in our conference. We're going to be having a conference at Grace Baptist. We would strongly encourage you to consider going, and you can actually find information about that on your handout that you were given on the way in. So let's go ahead and let's start. Welcome to the abortion debate. On behalf of Roscio Christi, Summit, the College Democrats, and the College Republicans, thank you for coming out or tuning in. We are so grateful you chose to participate in this incredibly important dialogue on the morality of abortion. I want to start by reminding everyone that we want tonight to be a display of respectful and civil dialogue. With that being said, we ask that you do not boo, heckle, or yell out at either speaker. You will have a time to ask questions at the end, and we encourage you to do so. The format of the debate tonight will be an opening statement from each speaker, followed by a rebuttal from each speaker. The speakers will then cross-examine one another, and then we will turn it over to the audience for a time of Q&A. And finally, we will close with their closing statements. Now that we are caught up on the layout of tonight's event, I want to take a moment to tell you about our speakers. Dr. Mike Adams is a criminology professor at the University of North Carolina, Wilmington. He lectures on the First Amendment and is actively involved in legal challenges to campus censorship. Dr. Adams is a Summit Ministry speaker and the author of three books, including Letters to a Young Progressive, and is also a columnist at the Town Hall and the Daily Wire. Dr. Willie Parker is an OBGYN specializing in abortions and reproductive justice advocate. Board certified and trained in preventative medicine and epidemiology through the Centers for Disease Control, Dr. Parker currently provides abortion care for women in Alabama and is the former medical director of Planned Parenthood in the metropolitan Washington, D.C. area. I would like to now present to you both of the speakers to come on up and take their places. And I would like to invite Dr. Adams to begin. Oh, I love that. That's better. We'll start with that. And now we will turn it over to Dr. Adams for his 20-minute opening statement. Your time begins now.
All right. This is awesome. Thank you so much for being here. I'm so excited about this event. I really do want to start by thanking Roscio Christi for putting on this presentation. I approached them with the idea, I guess it was almost a year ago, and I'm so thankful for them. Being a bold campus ministry that is not afraid to touch any of the hot button issues in our society. And I also really want to thank Summit Ministries, my home away from home in Manitou Springs, Colorado, for doing this. It's just fantastic. I'm so happy to be here. And let me go ahead and just jump into my argument this evening. I am here this evening to defend a very simple, logical syllogism. The major premise, or the first premise, is that it is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. My minor premise, second premise, is that abortion does, in fact, intentionally kill an innocent human being. And my conclusion is that, therefore, abortion is wrong. Now, I'm going to defend this syllogism in a way that might surprise you a little bit. I'm actually going to jump in and defend that minor premise, the second premise, first. And let me explain why I'm going to do that. When I present this syllogism to people that, you know, on the other side, they don't just dive in and say, sure, it is okay to intentionally kill an innocent human being. Instead, they try to deny that abortion does, in fact, kill an innocent human being. And so in order to bolster that minor premise, I've got to talk about the issue of when life begins. And to answer that question, we don't go to the Bible. We don't go to secular philosophy. We actually go to the science of embryology to decide when life begins. Let me quote from some embryology textbooks. Moore and Persaud, in their embryology textbooks, say, a zygote is the beginning of a new human being. Human development begins at fertilization. In another embryology textbook, T.W. Sadler says that the development of human beings begins with fertilization, a process by which the sperm from the male and the egg from the female unite to give rise to a new organism, which is the zygote. Now, I could go on and quote dozens of embryology textbooks, but I don't need to do that because they say exactly the same thing, that life, in fact, does begin at conception. But I find it interesting to share quotations from Planned Parenthood from time to time, particularly before they got into the business of abortion. President Alan Guttmacher, the president of Planned Parenthood, stated back in 1933, talking about life beginning at conception, he says, "This all seems so simple and evident that it is difficult to picture a time when it wasn't a part of the common knowledge." Peter Singer, a controversial pro-choice philosopher from Princeton University, is also honest about when life begins, and he says there is no doubt that from the first moments of its existence, an embryo conceived from human sperm and eggs is in fact a human being. Colorado University philosophy professor David Boonen says that a human fetus, after all, is simply a human being at a very early stage of his or her development. Abortion doctor Warren Hearn says this: "We have reached a point in this particular technology where there is no possibility of denial of an act of destruction by the operator. It is before one's eyes. The sensations of dismemberment flow through the forceps like an electric current." My opponent, however, Dr. Willie Parker, is not nearly as clear as the embryologist when it comes to the issue of when life begins. As a matter of fact, he gives several different incompatible explanations for when life begins. He says this, for example, in his book, Life's Work, A Moral Argument for Choice, on page 145. He says, "As a Christian and a scientist, I can authoritatively attest that life does not begin at conception. There is no scientific consensus." Actually, he cannot authoritatively attest to anything, because in his 217-page book, there is not a single endnote and not a single footnote. But the science of embryology says the exact opposite of what he is trying to tell you. He shifts and he says, "Life begins long before conception with the lives that enabled the unborn to come into being." He says that on page 149 of his book. Now, that's very interesting. He likes to say that life is this continuous process, and he suggests that there is this continuous life process between the mother and the offspring. That's absolutely preposterous. Dr. Willie Parker has performed over 10,000 abortions, and I ask you a simple question. In any of those 10,000 abortions, did he accidentally abort a mother? Of course he didn't, because he sees two distinct living and whole human beings in front of him, and there's absolutely no confusion about which one is which. He continues on page 150, and he says that between 22 and 25 weeks, that life is in a vague state. So in other words, he's agnostic on the question of whether we have a life between 22 and 25 weeks after conception. Now, that's bizarre, because in the previous paragraph, also on page 150, he says that a human life is viable at 22 weeks. How do you become a human life that is viable at 22 weeks and then suddenly for 3 weeks float in this vague state between life and not life? It is absolutely preposterous. It is absolute junk science. So let's be clear, absolutely clear about what Dr. Willie Parker and what abortionists do for a living. Andrew, hit the first clip. Look at the screen, please. Well, I believe that the science of embryology, and I believe that the visual evidence that you just saw establishes my minor premise, that abortion does, in fact, intentionally kill an innocent human being. Now we are ready to step back a little bit and move and couch this within my major premise, which is that it is, in fact, wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. Well, let me explain very clearly why I believe that it's wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. I look around this room right now and I see that we are all equal to one another, and there is a reason. We are valuable not by virtue of the kinds of things that we can do. We are valuable by virtue of the kind of thing that we are. It is our basic human nature that gives us value. And you either have it or you don't. It does not exist in degrees. You have it or you don't. And every single individual in this room has that basic human nature. And that is what gives us value. And that is why it is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. You know, if I were to try to contrast philosophically the position on what gives humans value, the position that is pro-life with the common pro-choice position, I could not possibly do a better job than Nancy Piercy, who is a philosophy professor at HBU, Houston Baptist University. In her recent book, Love Thy Body, she says it this way. She says that the pro-choice position is exclusive. It says that some people don't measure up. They don't make the cut. They don't qualify for rights of personhood. In contrast, the pro-life position is inclusive. If you are a member of the human race, you are in. You have the dignity and the status of a full member of the moral community. That is, you have infinite value from the point that you were, in fact, conceived. Now, in contrast, Dr. Willie Parker simply cannot decide where human value comes from. In his book, he is all over the map. Let me give you an example of things that he suggests confer value upon human beings. On page 97 of his book, he suggests that it is size that gives you value. He says this, that 91% of the abortions are performed in the first trimester, where it cannot be said that they have any distinctive parts. Now, first of all, let me just say something philosophically about that. It is absolutely absurd to attach your value as a human being to the size of your body. I mean, that sets up massive conditions of inequality. It would suggest that men are more valuable as human beings than women because on average they're taller, on average they weigh more. It is an absolutely irrelevant characteristic. But in addition to that, it's very clear that when Dr. Parker says that the fetus can't be said to have any distinctive parts, he's simply not telling the truth. Because on the previous page, page 96, he says, after every abortion, I make sure I find every part and I place them together, recreating the fetus. So there you have it. I guess if he put the parts together, there really were parts. How did that one fetus turn into a bunch of parts through a slow, methodical process of human dismemberment? That's what happened. But he shifts, and he suggests that instead it is our development that, in fact, gives us value. He says on page 12, the unborn cannot form anything like thoughts. Let me just say that's a really dangerous idea. To say that your value as a human being is contingent upon the complexity of the thoughts that you have. He expresses this elsewhere in a metaphor where he says, an acorn is not an oak tree. Yes, I am aware that an acorn is not an oak tree, but a toddler is not a senior citizen. And it simply does not follow that because a toddler is less complex, has fewer life experiences, fewer memories, less education, is less developed, that killing it somehow would be less of a moral crisis than killing someone who's older. It's nonsense. And once again, I'm aware that an acorn is not an oak tree, But it's very important to remind people that a human fetus is not an acorn. And that's why you can't step on it, you can't crush it, you can't feed it to a squirrel with moral impunity. So I believe that analogy absolutely fails. And so he shifts. At some point in the book, as a matter of fact, it's around page 150, he begins to talk about the issue of viability. And he suggests that, well, when you become viable as a fetus, that is the thing that actually gives you value. Well, I strongly disagree with that. Let me give you an example. I would say that viability probably occurs around 21 weeks. Dr. Parker says it's 22 weeks. So I'll defer on that because I don't want to complicate the thought experiment here, but I do want you to think about this for a moment. Imagine that a woman is pregnant in New York City and she has a viable fetus. She is 22 weeks pregnant. If she gets on a plane and she flies to Bangladesh, guess what? That human fetus is no longer viable because viability in Bangladesh doesn't occur till about 35 weeks. So let's just assume she's hanging out in Bangladesh. She doesn't like it very much, so she decides that she's going to come back to New York City. Are we actually going to suggest that she had a person there in her uterus in New York City, a non-person in Bangladesh, who when returning to the United States of America became a person for the second time? It is absolutely absurd. And you know what? It is also absolutely irrelevant because Dr. Parker says on page 150 once again that the human fetus is viable at 22 weeks. And then 44 pages later on page 194, he says that he performs abortions at 25 weeks. So that's interesting, isn't it? If there's a philosophical difference between a human in a biological sense and a person in a philosophical sense, and we are to say that that is viability, that that's the difference? Well, what does that mean? That means he kills people for a living by his own standard. But the thing is, the standard continues to shift everywhere. You can't keep up with it. And I can sit here and go on all night about the many things I disagree with Dr. Parker, but now we get to a point of agreement. We agree about two things. Dr. Willie Parker says that he will not do race-selective abortions. He also says that he will not do sex-selective abortions. So he has declared that it is wrong to engage in racial discrimination and gender discrimination. I absolutely agree. But do you see what the problem is here? He has traded away two forms of discrimination, race and gender, in exchange for three: size, level of development, and degree of dependency. I, for the record, am opposed to all five of those forms of discrimination. So let me just summarize my syllogism. My major premise, which I have defended with philosophy, is that it is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. My minor premise, which I have defended with the science of embryology and with visual imagery, is that abortion does, in fact, kill an innocent human being. My conclusion is that, therefore, abortion is wrong. That's my case. Thank you for listening.
Thank you to Dr. Adams. We will now invite Dr. Parker to start his opening statement, and he will also have 20 minutes.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. I won't use my full 20 minutes. I'm delighted to be here. Happy to share the stage with Professor Adams. I took this invitation from Ratio Christi because I like their slogan, having conversations that matter. And I am happy to be here. I'm happy to know that Dr. Adams has read my book. We didn't introduce the fact that I had a book, but he gave you a lot of information from my book. It was parsed and selected to make his point, but that's fine. I said I took the invitation to be here tonight to understand because my motto in life is first seek to understand and then to be understood. And in order to achieve that, I think if we're going to understand each other on an issue as volatile, contentious, and as important as abortion, we have to listen to each other. Someone said that we all think alike, none think too much. The late Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan said that everyone's entitled to their own opinion, but no one's entitled to their own facts. And the final axiom that I abide by, and I introduced these three thoughts into the conversation on purpose, is to set the tone for how I wish to conduct myself in all of my dealings, but in particular in a public forum. The final one is the logic and the reason of the Mahatma Gandhi. He says that honest disagreement is the beginning of progress. So I will, in the course of the night, express honest disagreement with my brother, Professor Adams. And I say my brother because I think some people might have the notion that because I do abortions that I don't have a faith identity. I too am a Christian. So I understand from the inside where the passion and the drive to live to your convictions come from. So as a Christian, I stand here and I say, rather than being mortal enemies, if anything happens in this conversation at all, it's more of a sibling argument and not a conversation between enemies and foes. As we all know, abortion is a freighted term. It's all at once medical, legal, philosophical, and religious, as you've heard from Professor Adams. Part of the problem with having a conversation about abortion as such a freighted term is that we often end up talking past each other because we don't lay groundwork of having definitions that will hold us in a certain context. I listened as Professor Adams went back and forth between philosophy, science, religion, and the law. And many of these terms, many of these disciplines use the same terms, but they have different implications once you set them in a context. So I want to do some of that, and so then it will allow me to ask some questions of Professor Adams and then maybe also clarify some of the, in my opinion, misrepresentations he made from the reading of my book. Now, let me start by saying what the scope of my book was when I wrote it. And I think it's best captured in a cartoon I saw recently. It was a cartoon of a conversation between a man and a woman. And they were having a conversation about where people come from, or at least birth. The man says to the woman, "You came from my rib," intimating the creation story of Adam and Eve. Man was created first. Woman was created from his rib, being taken from him when he was placed into a deep sleep. Now, if you've studied embryology, the embryology that Dr. Adams told you about, in embryologic development, in utero, the fetus as it forms, the primary template of the fetus is female, and is only under the influence of male hormones secreted by the gonads that are determined at conception, or the sex is established XY or XX, that the fetus differentiates into a male fetus. So biologically, the plausibility that a male was created first is biologically implausible, but I digress. In response to the man saying to the woman that you came from my rib, the woman says to him, "I didn't come from your rib, you came from my vagina." And what we have here are two different understandings of reproduction. On the one hand, you have a scientific understanding of reproduction. Babies come from women's vaginas. And on the other hand, you have a non-scientific, and in this case, a religious understanding that people come from other people's body parts. Now, the reality is that those two understandings are not interchangeable, right? And they're also not mutually exclusive. So what we have is often when we talk about reproduction, we have people talking about the scientific nature of reproduction and the biologic nature of reproduction. So we oftentimes have people flipping between concepts, and sometimes those concepts don't translate directly. For example, people are, the nature of the question tonight is the morality of abortion, right? Sometimes people use morality and ethics interchangeably. What is the difference between the two? Sometimes you heard Dr. Adams talk about, he laid out his syllogism. He said that it is wrong to kill an innocent human being. I agree. Abortion kills a human being. I agree. But never once did you hear Dr. Adams mention the word person, right? He did not mention the word person. He said the life begins at conception. I can take issue with that, and I can illuminate what I meant when I said that life began before conception. For example, in order to have a conceptus, you have to have a live sperm and a live egg. You can't get a live conception with a dead sperm and a dead egg. So that means that life, if you're going to use it as a definition of animation and procreativity and the ability to do so, it means that life had to begin before conception. So are you talking about life as an event? Or as he alluded to, as I say in my book, life is a process of interrelated events, right? So the beginning of life, when it occurs, is there is a scientific understanding of that. It often is framed in the terms of evolution. There is a non-scientific understanding of that. And I think Dr. King says that when we pose tension between science and religion, he described it best. He says that science gives humankind knowledge, which is power. Religion gives humankind wisdom, which is control. Science deals with facts. Religion deals with values. The two are not enemies. So it is quite possible to hold a scientific understanding of life and a religious or moral or philosophic understanding. And the thing is that since they're not mutually exclusive, the question is, how do they fit together? And how they fit together is usually a play of what one's conscience tells one. Conscience is one's individual or inner witness of what is right and what is wrong. So it is the notion that something as personal as reproduction that occurs in the body of a woman. As I said, Dr. Adams talked about human beings, but he never once mentioned person. And the personhood of a woman, and if we establish personhood, nobody would argue that a woman's a person. And by the law standard, personhood is established at birth, right? So women, without question, are people. But from the standpoint of the law, if personhood starts at birth, it's not, given that it's not debatable about whether or not a woman's a person, the question is, when is she not a person? You know, we can debate about whether or not a fetus is a person, but he never once mentioned personhood. He talked about human beings, and I agree. I agree with him. Women don't give birth to puppies. So fetuses are human beings, but they're not people. And if a fetus is not a person and a woman is a person, they may both have moral weight, but that moral weight is not equal. And the question becomes, given that a fetus is inside of a woman, how do you give rights to a fetus that you don't take away from the woman that's it, that it's inside of? And that is a fundamental question about what it means to be a person. So again, one of the questions I will have for Dr. Adams is how he defines person. And when he defines personhood, if women have that, my question is, when do they lose that? Is the pregnancy a state where a woman's a person in every other state? And when I say state, not her locale, but I mean by her physical status and stature at that time. Is a woman a person? And if she is on par with a man, and that was not stratified by gender when God created us all, the question is, when does a woman lose her personhood? And that question should not be debatable. But the conferring of personhood on a fetus with the intention of taking away that right from a woman is where it becomes problematic. And I think it was on that basis that the Supreme Court in 1973 decided the Roe v. Wade decision. And I think people have heard Roe v. Wade, but I don't think they know what it actually says. So I just want to, for the balance of my time, share a little bit of the thinking that went into the decision when Justice Harry Blackmun wrote the decision. And he said what was weighed when they decided on behalf of women being able to be in control of their bodies and to control their health and to make the decision about when and whether or not to become a mother, a personal decision between a woman and her provider. And if it's a moral or philosophical question between that woman and her God, and that decision is not open to public scrutiny or public weigh-in. First Amendment right may say you get to say how you feel about how a woman makes her decision, but it does not empower you to prohibit her from making her own decisions. Justice Blackmun said in the decision, the Roe v. Wade case was about Texas. He said that apart from the 14th Amendment, the whole notion of the Supreme Court weighing the constitutionality of denying a woman her right to end a pregnancy, he said that life begins at conception and is present throughout pregnancy is the position of the state of Texas, and that therefore the state has a compelling interest in protecting that life from and after conception. Justice Blackmun said, we need not resolve the difficult question of when life begins. When those trained in their respective disciplines of medicine, philosophy, and theology are unable to arrive at any consensus, the judiciary, at this point in the development of man's knowledge, is not in the position to speculate about that answer. In other words, there is no clear-cut consensus about exactly when life begins, even if you hold that deeply from the religious text that you hold authoritative. It should be sufficiently noted that, briefly, the wide divergence of thinking on this most sensitive and difficult issue will always be there. There's always been some strong support for the view that life does not begin until live birth. It appears to be the predominant thought in Judaism, and it may also be the predominant thought until fairly recently in most Protestant faiths, and it may be taken to represent the position of a large swath of other people, but the reality is the formal position about abortion is that it is a matter of conscience for the individual and her family. So physicians and their scientific colleagues have regarded the event with less interest and have tended to focus either upon conception, upon live birth, or upon the interim point of the fetus becoming viable, because the potential to live outside the mother's womb is what determines when the state has a compelling interest. So I have the position that, as someone who for the first 12 years of my career as an OBGYN who did not provide abortion care for women, my position about not doing so was until I was clear about what it meant for me to provide that care, I chose not to. But I was never questioning about the right of a woman to make that decision about something that is so self-determining. And what changed my mind had to do with an epiphany I had while listening to a sermon by Dr. Martin Luther King about what made the Good Samaritan good. He made that point in the sermon on the last day of the last evening of his life, where you all might know it as the Mountaintop Sermon, but Dr. King said something else in that sermon where he talked about what is our ultimate commitment and responsibility to our fellow person. The Good Samaritan story, you're probably the audience that knows that story better than any audience that I've ever spoken to, was when the person who stopped along the road to help a traveler who had been wounded by robbers, and everybody who passed that person by, whether by vocation or by kinship, who had an obligation to stop, they didn't. They passed by concerned about their well-being. The Samaritan, or the person who was not from his community, stopped to provide help. And Dr. King said that what made the Good Samaritan good was whereas everyone who had an obligation to help but who failed to do so because they were concerned about what might happen to them, what made the Good Samaritan good was his ability to reverse the question of concern. And he asked, instead of asking, what will happen to me if I stop to help this person, he asked, what will happen to this person if I don't stop to help him? So in light of the fact that 1 in 4 women in this society will have an abortion by the time they're age 45, in light of the fact that maternal mortality in this country is at an all-time high, and in light of the fact that when abortion is illegal, it is unsafe, the legal status of abortion is debatable by law, but the morality of helping someone in need, in this case a person, a woman, and if that need happens to be a pregnancy, is not up for debate. And so as a woman's health provider, knowing these facts, the question for me was, what do I do when a woman presents with that concern or that need to end her pregnancy safely? What do I do when a woman has a pregnancy that is lethally flawed? And in order for her not to incur the risk of maternal death related to pregnancy, what is my responsibility to her? As someone who's chosen medicine as a craft, I have an ethical responsibility to provide health care to that woman. And as a Christian, I feel that I have the moral responsibility to providing compassionate care to that woman, even in the face of people who stridently disagree with me, many of who share the same faith identity with me, and many of who stand silent or stand with disregard as 11 people have been murdered in the course of providing abortion care or seeking it. So the morality of abortion and the question of it, it depends on how you define morality and how you value life and whose life do you value. And my essential question is, the morality of abortion is determined by this question. Life matters. The life of a woman matters. Abortion is health care. And if women matter and if their lives matter, who should say when and whether or not they should receive the care that they are entitled to seek? And is it moral to deny women the care that for many of them is life-saving, simply because there are people who hold a certain religious belief and they disagree with that care?
Thank you, Dr. Parker. We are now going to move into our time of rebuttal. We're going to start with Dr. Adams. He will have 10 minutes, and you can begin now.
Thank you. I just want to clean up a couple of small things before I get to my major points here. First of all, Dr. Parker said that I did not use the term person at any point in my presentation. As a matter of fact, I used it repeatedly just to clarify that I did talk about that. Also, just a small thing here, not such a small thing, but Dr. Parker didn't spend much time on it. He talked about abortions being unsafe before Roe versus Wade. I have in my materials here a article by Dr. Mary Calderon, who was the international medical director of Planned Parenthood. She was giving a speech in 1959 in which she said in the late 1950s that the number of women dying as a result of unsafe abortions had gone all the way down to approximately, I think it was 256 in the year 1957. Now, the problem is that once Roe versus Wade then came along and became legal, the number of abortions being performed every year went up by several hundred thousand. So it raises a fundamental question. Does it make sense to kill several hundred thousand innocent human beings to save several hundred? He is begging the question and ignoring my minor premise in the syllogism. So I wanted to address that, and that relates to another point that he made. Yes, he did mention the fact that there have been 11 abortion providers who have been killed in about the last half century, but there have been 60 million innocent human beings aborted. That's something he didn't mention. And they matter. They absolutely matter because they're valuable, because of their basic human nature. Also, he talked about Roe versus Wade. Roe versus Wade was just simply absolutely wrong, and it was wrong in two ways. First of all, it said that there was no scientific consensus in 1973 on the issue of when life begins. The fact of the matter is that there was scientific consensus, as Alan Guttmacher, the president of Planned Parenthood, said all the way back in 1933 when he said it's hard to remember a time when something as simple as that wasn't known by everyone. So it was wrong, but I'll tell you something else about Roe versus Wade, and understand what Roe versus Wade did. It did give the authority of the states to ban abortions after viability, but the very same day Doe versus Bolton was issued by the Supreme Court, and it said that if a woman had a health interest, it could trump the state's interest in stopping that abortion. And they defined that health loophole in such a way that was so big you could drive a Mack truck through it. The health reasons didn't just stick to life or even physical things, but emotional problems and psychological problems, so that if a woman 8 months pregnant was simply stressed out, by the prospect of having a child, then she could trump the state's interest in killing a viable, innocent human being. Now, what's crazy about Roe versus Wade is it said that a woman's reproductive right to choose was inextricably bound to the question of when life begins. It then said, we don't know when life begins. So guess what? That means you don't know the parameters of a woman's right to choose. That decision was a scientific and logical disaster, and that is why it must be absolutely overturned. Now, one other thing I want to say about this, the idea of the Good Samaritan, I agree that the Good Samaritan is a good parable, because I often ask the question, who is my neighbor? And I'll answer that question for you right now. The unborn is my neighbor. And you notice something about that parable. When someone was robbed and beaten and lying by the side of the road, you know what the Good Samaritan didn't do? The Good Samaritan didn't stop by the side of the road and slit his throat and slowly and methodically dismember him. I believe that the Good Samaritan parable is a pro-life parable, and I don't appreciate it being hijacked in the name of God. That is obscene. I respect your right to speak, but don't abort
That's
my
not
sentences.
Productive. That's not necessary. Thank you.
I want to say some other things about Dr. Parker's argument. He makes some serious mistakes in suggesting that bodily autonomy is absolute. The right of a woman to have bodily autonomy is absolute. He says elsewhere, he spoke about it tonight, but he says elsewhere that a woman should be able to make decisions about her own sexuality. Let's be clear about this. The right to bodily autonomy is important, but it is not absolute. We cannot ever be in a position where we endorse the Orwellian absurdity of actually dismembering bodies in the name of bodily autonomy. Dr. Parker revisits this issue of life before conception when he talks about how we have a live sperm and a live egg before conception. Very clearly, he is confusing the fallacy, he's making the fallacy of confusing parts with wholes. Let me illustrate this. As I reach to the back of my hand and I pluck the back of my hand, there are hundreds, and if I keep doing it, thousands of live skin cells that are plunging to their deaths. There is no one in this room who thinks that I just committed mass murder, because we all understand the difference between a part of a human being and a distinct living and whole human being. So when Dr. Parker talks about the sperm and the egg being alive before conception, that's true, but they die off in the process of coming up with a new distinct living and whole human embryo. This debate is not about how parts of human beings die naturally. It's about intentionally killing complete human beings, distinct, living, and whole human beings, and doing it in the name of bodily autonomy. Furthermore, Dr. Parker talks about legalism. He talks about personhood, and he uses personhood in such a way, not really a philosophical way, but a legalistic fashion, to suggest that, you know, you're just a person, essentially, when the law says that you are, when they recognize you. And I will tell you something, that this debate, let me remind you this evening, it is not about whether or not abortion is legal, it is about whether or not abortion is moral. And there is a profound difference between that which is legal and that which is moral. If you want to come up with an example, Dr. Parker says you cannot murder a fetus, you can only murder a person. That's a legalistic argument. But if you want to come up with an example in this country of something that was legal but immoral, think about the 1927 case of Buck versus Bell, in which the state of Virginia was forcing women to be sterilized simply because they were mentally deficient. And in affirming that law in the state of Virginia, Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes said this, three generations of imbeciles are enough. I want you to think about that for just a second. And that came back to bite us as that phrase was used against us in the Nuremberg trials a few years later. There is a distinction between the legal and the moral. Dr. Parker suggests that this is about preferences. He has stated that choice should be the default position. We should simply trust the woman, and choice should be the default position. In other words, he is saying abortion is just a preference. You have seen this idea expressed before when you see bumper stickers that say, "Don't like an abortion, don't have one." Imagine some fool driving down Market Street with a bumper sticker that said, "Don't like slavery, don't own one." Think about how obscene that would be, because it confuses a truth claim with a preference. And finally, this is extremely important. Dr. Parker talks about personhood and asks the question as to when a woman loses her personhood. At what point does that happen? Here he is actually trying to set up a situation involving competing rights between the woman and between the unborn. He's done this in the past, saying that a fetus cannot be more important than the woman who is carrying it. That is absolutely correct. They have equal rights, and that includes the right to life. But you cannot pit the right to life against the right to liberty or against the pursuit of happiness. Why? Because there is no moral right to intentionally kill an innocent human being, even if it makes you freer, even if it makes you happier. Because if we did that, that would negate all rights for everyone, including the right to life itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Adams. We will now turn it over to Dr. Parker for his 10-minute rebuttal, and his time starts now.
My only rebuttal is first of all, it's clear that Professor Adams is well-trained in debate, and I know that I'm not trained in debate. I'm not trained in philosophy. I am trained in medicine, and I know that facts matter, and I know that the facts, as Dr. Adams tried to represent them with regard to medicine, are his facts. They're not medical facts. But that's not even important. Even if he, on every point, if he is right about the notion of about guilt or innocence, and about human beings. Again, I go back to the notion that I need to be clear about how he defines personhood, and if pregnancies are fetuses, and I've intentionally not referred to a fetus as a baby, because baby is not a medical or scientific term. It has many meanings, but it doesn't have with regard to this conversation about abortion and the morality of abortion. If a fetus is a baby, then an abortion is infanticide. And infanticide, by definition, can't happen until you're born. So the notion of using unborn baby is a term that lacks clarity, and it muddles the water when you're trying to decide about issues of morality. Just like the whole false narrative of pro-life and pro-choice. I too am pro-life. I am pro-life of the mother. But pro-life does not necessarily mean being anti-abortion. I think a more precise term would be to be anti-abortion and pro-reproductive rights, pro-reproductive health care. In the absolute way in which Dr. Adams describes the issue, there is no room to make distinctions and decisions about pregnancies gone awry. You know, I don't have to misrepresent and say 88% of abortions that happen, as he intimated or said, happen in the first trimester. They happen long before there's any, quote, point of viability, and that happens many times long before there's the ability to diagnose sometimes the tragic outcomes that lead women to have abortions at later stages in pregnancy. But the bottom line is, when do women lose the right to make the decisions about their health and their bodies? And that right is conferred by their innate rights to be self-determining. Dr. Martin Luther King said that, you know, rights, human rights are rights that are neither conferred by nor given by the state. But the state has a responsibility to secure those rights. And there are those who, because of their particular religious beliefs, would run roughshod over the rights of women to take care of themselves. And in fact, I've not heard Dr. Adams recite or reference any other religious frame of reference around reproduction, only Christianity. And that is problematic in a country that is pluralistic as ours. There are people in our country who are not Christian. And if your argument is that America is a Christian nation and that the Constitution is based on Christianity and on the Bible, does that mean that people who don't share a Christian identity are morally and ethically obligated to have the same notions about reproduction that Christians do? Isn't that Christian supremacy? I know that there are those who believe that everyone should be Christian. I too am Christian, but I respect the fact that there are others who are not. And so we can talk about what you've heard is a conversation that has interwoven realities about reproduction and abortion from medicine, from philosophy, from religion. The majority of it's been from a religious point of view. But what for those people who aren't religious? Should we be making laws on the basis of specific religious understandings? Or should the laws be rooted in principles that govern everybody's pathway to conscience? Because while conscience is universal, the pathway whereby they reach it is not. And so with regard to people who can become pregnant being able to act conscientiously with regard to their decision about when and whether or not to become a mother, the question is not whether or not we should hold people to standards religiously that match our identity that we declare collectively. It is, what does it mean to hold conscience sacred, and who has conscience and who has the right to exercise their conscience? And how do we preserve the space for people to exercise their conscience when we disagree? Thank you.
We would like to take this brief opportunity to give both of you a chance to take a water break and to recuperate before we start our cross-examination. I'd also like to mention that we have a hashtag that we would love for you guys to use as you're talking about this event tonight on different platforms of social media, and that is going to be hashtag the abortion debate. We would love for you guys to share your thoughts, your opinions. You'll also have a time to do that for the Q&A. But until then, that is the hashtag, and we will start back with our cross-examination in just a moment. All right, we are going to begin our cross-examination. Sorry, this was not a break. This was a water break for our speakers to have a chance to drink something. I'm sorry about that. We are going to go ahead and start with our cross-examination so that we can stay on time tonight. We have a lot to get through. We want to make sure that you guys have a chance to hear the speakers in all of the different areas that we have tonight. So now that they have refreshed themselves, we're going to start with our cross-examination. And that is going to happen by Dr. Adams asking questions for 7 minutes, and then we will turn it over to Dr. Parker to do the same. So Dr. Adams, you have the floor for your 7 minutes of questions.
Yeah, first of all, I would ask the audience to direct your attention to the screen. Andrew, play the second clip.
Now, Seattle has some particular significance for me for lots of reasons. I've got a lot of family here, some of whom are here in the audience tonight. I also had my first abortion at the Seattle Planned Parenthood. Yay! Notice I said first. I said first, and I don't want Seattle, I don't want you guys to feel insecure. It was my best one. Heads and tails above the rest. If I could Yelp review it.
Well, the individual you saw laughing and clapping about the intentional killing of innocent human beings was Dr. Willie Parker. And the first question is pretty natural. Dr. Parker, is intentionally killing innocent human beings really funny?
Do I get the answer?
Yes, please.
I think you just asked me a non-question. You should have asked me what I was clapping and laughing at. And what I was clapping and laughing at was Martha Plimpton, who's a comedian. And I was clapping and laughing at her boldness to use her chosen craft to reject stigma and shame around women who have abortion. Her personal decision to disclose that she'd had an abortion and to turn it into a joke was a form for her of pushing back on the notions that women who have abortions, and if the statistics are appropriate, in this room, there are 1 in 4 women in this room have had an abortion. There are women here who've had abortions, whether they clap about it or not, or whether they speak about it or not. But most of the women who've had abortions often live in a cloud of stigma and shame. And I was clapping at a woman who had made a decision in her life that was personal, that was her right to do so, felt empowered enough to push back and to empower other women, perhaps, to reject stigma and shame. And so, yes, it was funny that this woman, under the direct scrutiny, knowing that she's a public figure and that this would be out there, yeah. that she found power to claim her own life experience.
Okay, next question.
don't use his timer. Please, please, hold. You can clap at the end. Thanks.
You complained that I only went to one source of information for scientifically describing abortions. Let's go to another. Supreme Court Justice Anthony Kennedy, who consistently rules in favor of upholding the major provisions of Roe versus Wade, described D&E abortions this way. The fetus in many cases dies just as a human adult or child would. It bleeds to death as it is torn limb from limb. The fetus can be alive at the beginning of the dismemberment process and can survive for a time while its limbs are being torn off. My question is, do you feel the slightest bit of sympathy for the human beings that you subject to this procedure?
First of all, Justice Kennedy is not a physician, and what he described as an abortion procedure was not an accurate description. There is dismemberment involved, but I am no more or less sympathetic to the process that I'm doing than I am to the woman that I'm doing it for. When I do an abortion, I am clear what she has asked me to do for her. Mm-hmm. I'm clear that she's asked me to remove a fetus from her. I'm clear that in your terms, it is intentional killing of a fetus. But because it is not a person, that is why if you were to call the police on a day that I'm doing abortions, they won't come because abortion is not murder. So I have sympathy for the person that I need to have sympathy for and empathy and compassion, and that is the woman for whom I'm doing the procedure. If I had moral misgivings about what I was doing, it would be difficult for me to do it.
I understand. Okay, well, then my first one wasn't accurate, my second one's not accurate. Let's keep trying. Let's go to abortion doctor Warren Hearn, who has written the book Abortion Practice. Let's see what he has to say. On page 142 of his book, he describes doing a D&E abortion in which he says, as the skull is grasped, a sensation that it is collapsing is almost always accompanied by the expulsion of white brain matter from the skull. Is that accurate?
That is accurate.
That is accurate. Okay. And you perform D&E procedures?
I do.
Okay. So when you crush a human skull, it's not really gray matter, it's white brain matter that oozes out?
What's your point?
No, I'm asking you a question. Is the brain matter that oozes out when you crush a human skull white?
What does it matter?
What does it matter?
Yes, what does it matter? I get you're going for theatrics, and you made your point.
I am going for medical accuracy because you said I wasn't.
Okay.
So I went to an abortion manual. That's what I did. So I responded to your criticism.
You've described what I do. So what is your point?
My point is that it intentionally kills an innocent human being. Would you concede the point?
My first concession was to your first two syllogisms, that abortion kills a human being. It is the intentional disruption of a pregnancy that kills a human being. And I made the distinction in that's why I asked you to be more precise in your definition of why you say abortion kills a human being, but you've never said abortion kills a person.
Okay, well, you can ask me about that when you ask questions. Just one final question. How many innocent human beings have you intentionally killed in your life's work?
I don't know. I don't measure my work.
You've lost count.
If it's a million,
10,000?
20,000. 20,000? What's the difference?
What's the difference between 20,000 and 30,000?
Yeah.
10,000 dead human beings. Okay. That's the difference. Okay.
So that's more culpable than killing one person. If I was killing people, if I was committing murder, I wouldn't have gotten to do 10,000. Someone would have called the police and they would have...
Our time is up.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Addis, and thank you, Dr. Parker, for responding. Okay. We are now going to turn the 7 minutes over to you to ask questions to Dr. Addis, and your time begins now.
Yeah. Dr. Addis, as I cited, it's unclear to me when you say you, I didn't hear you, you say you used person, you used human being, and what if you use person, you're using person and human being interchangeably. All of the laws, all the rights and privileges that we have in this country are based on personhood. And personhood is established at birth. That's not simply a legal definition. The morality behind the legality is related to the law behind the law or the code upon which it is based. That is why when we've had legal situations like slavery, when people dug deeper and the moral assessment of the law failed the test, slavery was overturned. Mm-hmm. In the same regard, the moral test around whether or not abortion should be legal was determined by the same way. And it was based on personhood and the compelling interest that the state has in protecting the personhood of a woman, and that that falls short when it comes to the pregnancy that she's carrying. So help me to understand by your definition why you use human being and person interchangeably when the law does not. And many religious traditions, and even Christianity was absent on that other than Catholicism, but all of a sudden now personhood begins at conception.
Okay. I do reject the distinction between human being and person, and here's one reason I do it. The Dred Scott versus Sanford case was one of many tragic, wrongly decided Supreme Court cases in American history. And what that case did was to distinguish between a human being in a biological sense and a person in a philosophical sense. What it said is that some human beings don't measure up. And it conferred upon some human beings a right to define other human beings out of personhood. And it is that logic that caused slavery to be perpetuated and inequality to be perpetuated, and that's why I reject that distinction.
Why did the Dred Scott case not hold with regard to the Roe v. Wade case? If that logic, if that was to extend into the uterus, why was Dred Scott not relevant during the Roe v. Wade decision?
Oh, that's actually very simple, because they denied altogether that we knew about the humanity of the unborn. That's why, if you read the decision.
Well, I did, I have. And
well, they say that.
They
said something in Roe that they didn't say in Dred, which is that we are agnostic on the question of whether we have a human being. Dred didn't say that.
They said you're agnostic about whether it is a person. But I don't want to argue with you that about, but the question, again, based on that, with the personhood of a woman, when does she lose that?
She doesn't.
Okay. So what does it mean to be a person?
Well, again, once you're a human, I did this in my opening presentation. I was very clear about this.
What is a person?
Once you are biologically a human, you have full rights of personhood. Okay, so I have equated the two. Everyone's in from the point of conception.
And what is your standard for that? What is your source?
Is that a religious understanding? The science of embryology establishes that we are distinct, living, and whole human beings from the point of conception, and we have full rights.
I've never seen an embryology text. There's nowhere in Moore, where it says embryology texts do not talk about persons.
That's not what I said.
You said you established personhood based on the science.
No, I said once you're a human, you have the full rights of personhood. I refuse to make a legal distinction.
Okay. Well.
Clear?
What's clear is that everybody's entitled to their own opinion and nobody's entitled to their own facts or
their
definition.
That's why I go to the science of embryology.
Okay.
That's why I went.
You are parsing the science of embryology, and nowhere in the science of embryology in the text does it talk about the whole spectrum of embryologic development does not talk about personhood because personhood is not a scientific definition.
Right?
So how can you use scientific data to establish a definition that's not rooted in science?
I'm not doing that. I'm using embryology to establish that the unborn is human. I'm saying that every human has full rights.
Did I not say that every fetus, every conceptus is a human because women don't give birth to puppies.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
But stages of development matter. Therein lies the question about, you talk about moral weight and the appropriateness of decisions and what happens. And the question is whether or not the moral weight of a fetus or a pregnancy is the same as a woman. You say it is. So if there's a fetus that is an anencephalic, non-viable, should a woman have the right to end that pregnancy?
I believe that a woman should have a right to end a pregnancy when it threatens her life. Because the fetus and the woman both have a right to life. And let me give you a good example of that. A good example is an ectopic pregnancy. When an ectopic pregnancy, that's a situation where the fetus obviously begins to form in the fallopian tube. It's outside of the uterus. And if that pregnancy continues, it will burst that fallopian tube.
I know this.
And
very
not
well.
Only will the fetus die, but the woman will die as well.
Thank you.
So in a situation like that, we would remove it. But you notice that is not intentionally killing an innocent human being in that situation because the death is not intentional, it is foreseeable. And you have to understand in that situation, it's not the malice of the abortion doctor that produces the death of the fetus. It is an underlying physical pathology, which is the but-for causation.
And one final question for you. Who should decide when women have reasons that are legitimate for them to end their pregnancies?
Well, I believe that Doe versus Bolton was wrongly decided. And I believe in situations like that, health should have been something narrower to include a life exception.
And so that... Yeah. Health is established by a trained healthcare provider, a woman and her healthcare provider, right?
Well, sure.
So then that would mean spaces where people try to decide whether or not a woman has a legitimate reason would be overstepping bounds, right?
They would be able to make a doctor certainly would be able to make a decision that there is an ectopic pregnancy that threatens the life of the woman, and the woman would have a natural right to end the pregnancy.
So an ectopic pregnancy is the only reason a woman should be able to end the pregnancy?
There could be other examples where the life is threatened.
Okay, that was a great final question. Thank you both so much for that. We are now going to move into a time of Q&A. Yes, please feel free to clap for both of them. Thank you. We appreciate your support. So what we are going to do for our time of Q&A is we are going to have you line up at these two microphones. If you want to ask a question to Dr. Parker, we're asking that you do this one to his side. And if you want to ask a question to Dr. Adams, to do it on his side. Please, and I want to be very clear here, please ask a question. It must be very concise, very clear, and it must actually be a question. We do not want to have to cut off the mic, but we want to make sure that everyone has a chance to answer questions. You may begin, yes.
Dr. Parker. Two-part question. What's the average age of a woman that gets an abortion in your clinic?
Okay. The average age of a woman who has an abortion...
In your clinic.
In my clinic is the same as everywhere, so it's about 20.
Okay. Are most of these women somewhat fragile or weakened because of the decision they're making? And what does Jesus say about what you're doing with the weak?
When you say weak, are you mean like are they in distress or are they psychologically damaged by the process?
I would assume you're inherently distressed.
Okay. Well, an essential part of abortion care is to make sure that people who are making that decision are not under duress. And counselors are trained, as well as I, with the ultimate say-so if I'm doing the procedure, assure that that person is not making that decision under duress, that they have the clarity, and that they are not being induced in any way. With regard to the reason I asked for precision is there's the assertion with junk science that there are psychological consequences to abortion, like post-abortion syndrome, where women have higher rates of suicide and depression, and that is not, the weight of the scientific evidence shows that that is False.
Okay, going back to my question.
And then you said,
what would Jesus say about you aiding and abetting murder?
Jesus would, well, strangely and interestingly to me, for all of the assertions that people make around what Jesus would say about abortion, Jesus said nothing about abortion. And so there are people who infer what they think Jesus would say about abortion. And as I told in my Good Samaritan story, it was about Jesus never said, Jesus said, how you treat people in distress is more of a function of your relationship to God than your public declarations of your relationship to God.
All right, we're going to turn it over for your question.
Hey, Dr. Adams,
hey,
thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Two quick questions, and just for a little bit of clarification. And your opening statement was your stance that the woman and the fetus are equal beings, persons, they're equal, and that's why you're against the stance of abortion.
Well, they have equal rights to life, yes.
And just to clarify, you said that you are in support of an abortion if it's a threat to the mother's life.
Yes.
So if the child is a threat to the mother's life because it has a disability that will cause them to not have a successful lifespan, are you saying that that child is not as equal as the fetus that... Are you saying that the mother's value then has more value than the child that would not have a successful lifespan?
I do not use handicaps to justify abortion. That's eugenics.
All right, we ask that you not do that so she can continue her question. Thank you.
So you may have to cut me off because I'm not a doctor nor a debater. So what I want to ask is this is a little more personal. So I stand here as a 54-year-old man who was born in Sacramento, California to a mother who chose to give birth to me instead of aborting me. Mm-hmm. So I was adopted at 1 year old. And when I hear these debates, I kind of listen to people get caught in the weeds, and I think you can debate them forever. So the question I have for both of you when I look at this is, when I think about me and the uniqueness of who I am, I only come around once in a whenever, ever. My opportunity was one time. And I think sometimes it's easy to get caught up in
Excuse me, sir, I'm going to need you to
my question is
take
this.
It right to the
I'm
question.
Just real, well, people talk longer than this. Give me a second.
I know, I'm sorry.
My
I just
question
need you
will
to
be quick once I get to it.
Well, I know, I need you to get to it now.
In the debate.
I need you to get to it now, please.
Okay. My question is, how do you deal with the uniqueness of a human life that we don't even know if it exists any further than on this earth? Within the whole universe, our lives are incredibly unique. So as a doctor who removes that life and participates in it, how do you speak to a person like me who would not be here were abortion a lot more obvious back when I was a child?
Well, I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad that you have achieved the aspirations that you feel comfortable, you feel great about the life that you have. I'm glad that you're a reflection of the fact that your mother had a pregnancy that, whether she was ambivalent about it, however she became pregnant, she decided to give birth because that was the decision that she could live with, and she was also clear that she wasn't able to parent, and so she had enough love for you to put you in a position to be where you are. But equally, that what should have been supported is the fact that if you were not here talking to me, I would know nothing about you or your mother's story, and her right to have made that decision would mean that somebody valued her decision to actualize the potential of the life that she had. And there's no backseat driving or second-guessing the decision that your mother made. There are people who would say, how could she give away a baby that she gave birth to? There are people who would say, how could you not give birth when you know what life is? So I want 54 years from now, 54 years later, question the decision your mother made. Your being here is what you've decided to do after you were born. But her decision about whether or not to allow you here was her decision.
He asked the question of both of us. So, Dennis, you've gone somewhere. Where are you now? Have you sat back down? There he is. I'll answer it quite differently. Dr. Parker has just restated his previous position that abortion is a preference and that there is no moral difference if you are alive or dead. I disagree with that. I believe your mother made the right choice, and I'm glad you're here for that reason. Because it was a moral good that she did.
Okay, all right, we're gonna keep going with the questions. I know clapping is easy, comes naturally. We're gonna take it right here.
I have a question for Dr. Adams.
Sure.
So you said that life begins with inception, with mm-hmm. conception. And I accept that. I think life does begin with conception. But mm-hmm. I'd like to make a distinction between life begins and while life happens. And when you talked about that an acorn is not a tree, and I would say that at conception, an embryo...
I was quoting him. That wasn't mine.
I'm saying, and an embryo is not a person. So with acorns, we rake up acorns, we put them in the trash, and there are no trees. But some acorns embed in the soil, they grow roots, they get nourished, they come through the soil, and then they become a tree. Then life happens. And I would say that with people, the same thing.
We need
thing.
This to be a question.
I have a question.
All right, well, I
okay.
need it to be
so
a question.
So I'm just making a comment first. So
I know you are, but I'm asking okay. you just to do
question.
A question,
so
please.
My question is, if a 12-year-old girl is raped, and then are we required to force that 12-year-old girl to give up an adolescence, to deliver a child, and for the rest of her life to know that child is the result of a rapist? And are we required to a woman who knows that she is going to produce a seriously deformed child, that for the rest of her life, she's going to have to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to care for that child who is not going to have a full and successful life? And finally, I'm always amazed at how we're so concerned about birthing children, but we're not concerned about caring them, about health care, about
okay,
food.
All right, we and are so, going to stop that, you. And we're going to take that question. So, Mike, would you like to respond to his question?
Well, there were a series of questions. You went back to eugenics again, and you asked whether I thought a handicap justified abortion. Well, you're shaking your head, but you did it. I heard you do it. And I do not support eugenics. I believe that the handicap life is worth living, no matter how much it costs.
All right, I'm going to ask you to please stop clapping, you guys. I know, but we want to make sure we have a lot of people who can answer their questions or ask their questions, which means no clapping until the end of this. Please.
And when I became pro-life on the issue of abortion, I believed in a rape exception. And then something quite interesting happened. A friend, an adult friend, who knew that she was adopted, she knew it, and she began to investigate the circumstances of her adoption. She found out that she was conceived in rape, and my girlfriend at the time told me about that, and she said to me, she says, that is the reason why I don't support a rape exception to a ban on abortion. And I said, well, I do. And she said, are you saying that my friend Laura should be executed for a crime that she did not commit, an innocent human being, when the law will not allow the rapist to be executed? Are you saying that my friend Laura should be executed? I said, well, not now. And she said, well, what's the difference between the innocent human being she is now and the innocent human being that she was in the womb that would have justified killing her for a crime she didn't commit at that earlier stage of development? I said, I can't think of one. And so I changed my mind. That's not a sign of weakness. It is a sign of honesty.
Thank you, Dr. Adams. All right, we're going to move over to
this. There was one more
mic.
Question.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, please.
And the third
to the
question
part.
Was an accusation that we are not consistent somehow in the pro-life movement. You know, we're just opposed to abortion, but we're not necessarily comprehensively pro-life. Let me just say what an arrogant thing that is to say. If you had a friend who was collecting money for the American Cancer Society, and you walked up and attacked that person and said, you're not comprehensively anti-disease, you're not comprehensively pro-life, because you do not also collect money for AIDS research, that's just not a fair criticism. Think about that for just a moment. Just because we are opposed to the intentional killing of innocent human beings does not mean that we are responsible for curing all of society's ills, but here's what's important. We actually are doing things for women who are facing difficult situations. For example, Lifeline Pregnancy Center here in Wilmington, North Carolina, provides resources for poor women, and the pro-life movement has more crisis pregnancy centers than there are abortion clinics in this country. So stop saying you're inconsistent, because the question in this debate is not about the kind of human being I am, but the kind of entity that the unborn is. If I become inconsistent in some way because I disagree with some of your politics, that does not mean the unborn is somehow non-human and lacking in basic rights. That's the fallacy in your argument.
Thank you. We're going to take it right here.
Hey, so we disagree on just this issue, but you seem like a nice guy, so I'm not going to attack your character. I'm just going to ask a pretty simple question. So,
thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. So based on just your beliefs, when do you think personhood, by your definition, begins?
I think personhood, a function of personhood is sentience, being able to have a interest, and that is, it is not an instantaneous event. If it were instantaneous, and if it were merely a function of being sentient and having skill to reason and that kind of thing, babies aren't people. Right. That's not my argument. But in terms of when we collectively decide that we have a compelling interest to protect the life of a person, that point unambiguously happens at birth. And that's why I was posing the question to Dr. Adams around when a woman who's been born, who has interest, who can make decisions, makes the decision not to continue a pregnancy, and that interest about whether or not to become a pregnancy, is the fetus that she's carrying have a compelling interest to compete with hers? When she decides that it doesn't, my issue and my challenge and my effort to support a legal standard that allows her to make that decision means that she is a person, and the pregnancy that she's carrying doesn't have any standing before the law to carry out what I think is the protection of her sacred status of being a person. And so I know that might be one of the things that we honestly disagree about, but it is a woman, the most objective standard of when personhood begins is at birth. And even when you don't have sentience in a way that would make you smarter than a Jack Russell puppy, and I'm not being graphic, but I'm saying it's not merely can you reason, can you talk, it is at personhood begins at birth, and that's why there's no such thing as abortion on demand, and as it was represented by a doctor, as you can't terminate a pregnancy after 25 completed weeks if there's no other reason.
If I may, so then if it begins at birth, what is the difference between a fetus one day before the birth and a born child after the day of birth?
If you notice that I said personhood begins at birth, and birth occurs at any gestational age, and whether or not that fetus can survive outside the womb is a function of what we call viability. So one of the reasons somebody can't walk in at 26 weeks and say, I'm pregnant and I just don't want to be, and have somebody do an abortion, is because at 25 completed weeks, a fetus, when it becomes a baby at birth, can't survive outside the womb. And the decision was that at that point, a woman cannot make the decision to end a pregnancy because the state now has a compelling interest. And Dr. Adams made a big deal about my definitions being legalistic. We do have to have legal definitions when we live in a pluralistic society where people are entitled to think freely for themselves and to make decisions about their lives based on their culture, their religion, and the things that they value.
Thank you, Dr. Parker. We're going to take it right here.
Hello. So with your stance, and there's quite a few points that I agree with you on, but as Dr. Parker here brought out, that living in a pluralistic society as we do, as we may try to limit the circumstances a woman can have abortion under, that doesn't necessarily stop them from having the abortion. So the question is, what evil is lesser, and which one are you willing to have at the trade of the other?
Oh, well, that's actually easy, because there is no pluralism problem from my perspective here, because if you were listening carefully to my argument, I supported my minor premise not with the Bible. I supported it with the science of embryology. And I supported the major premise with philosophy, okay? And so, you know, that's not a problem. And I'm sorry, the other part of your question?
I was asking if, because people are going to decide if they're really
because determined. They're going to happen anyway.
Yes,
okay,
exactly.
Yeah. That, you know, the idea that just because something will happen anyway, that there's no use in having a law, is fallacious reasoning. We have murders, crimes, laws against murder and laws against rape, and they still happen. So we don't say because the crimes still happen, therefore make it legal. okay? What we have learned very clearly from the experiment of Roe versus Wade, we don't know exactly how many more abortions are a result of Roe versus Wade. We know it's in the hundreds of thousands. And so you want to talk about trade-offs. I say it's a very bad trade-off to intentionally kill hundreds of thousands of innocent human beings just to save hundreds who would have died in back alley abortions. Okay, so I do a very rational analysis there, and I don't rely upon religion to make that to come to that conclusion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Adams. We'll take it right here.
This kind of stems from the other question. You had said that you don't believe that I don't know how to say the word, but infanticide, you don't agree with that. But in New York, children are being left, children are being born after a failed abortion and are being left on the table to die. So you said that, you have two quotes that I wrote down, and to me they are contradictory. So you said, abortion is not murder. Did you say that?
I did.
Okay. And then you said, abortion kills a human being. Did you say that?
I did.
Okay, so my brain is having a hard time understanding that. If abortion is not murder, is your statement, and abortion kills a human being, is your statement, that doesn't agree to me.
Let me turn it around and see if this will give you some clarity. Is the death penalty killing?
Yes.
When the state does the death penalty, are they murdering inmates?
Yes.
Okay, so you're anti-death penalty.
Well, yes, I am. In the case that if the person that is being killed cannot be kept safe, you know, keeping the public safe, then all right, let me think about it. I am not a debater, as you can tell, but I am against the death penalty when a person, you know, can be kept, you know, keep others safe. So I don't want a person that's killing other people to be allowed to be in prison and killing other people.
And in all fairness to you, with all due respect, I wasn't trying to trap you. What I was trying to make the distinction about is abortion is killing, but all killing is not murder, right? And this, and hence, I wasn't being flippant when I said, the reason if you call the police while I'm doing an abortion and they won't come is because the definition of murder is a legal one, and it's the intentional killing of a person. And no, you can call the police anywhere in this country and they will not come and arrest somebody who's doing an abortion. Even though you don't like it and you think it's, and I say it's intentional killing, it doesn't rise to the standard of murder. And what people are trying to do is change the laws, and that's certainly your prerogative. But is it murder what happened to the woman in Ireland who was 19 weeks pregnant and her water was broken and the pregnancy was non-viable and they refused to do her abortion because there was a heartbeat and she became septic and died? They intentionally did not treat her and she died. Was that murder?
I'm sorry, but I didn't really understand what you're saying because I'm focusing on my question of the infanticide.
So infanticide is the killing of infants.
Right.
An infant is a baby. And the distinction I was making, morally, there's a different moral implication and a different legal implication from doing an abortion and killing a baby.
But right. In New York, right, there are babies being...
We're going to end this banter. Okay. It's very interesting.
All right, last question, the Samaritan woman... the Good Samaritan, that's the story. The Good Samaritan, they didn't get paid to, that person, the person that was the Good Samaritan did get paid to help the person, whereas in abortion, it's a profitable industry. So, you know, I don't see the comparison between the Good Samaritan and abortionists, because abortionists make
a lot
of money.
Okay, we're going to stop that question. I think we got pretty clear what you would like to respond to. Would you like to respond?
Well, I think, with all due respect, I think you're getting lost in the analogy, and the analogy was about people acting on behalf of others when they have, as I said, 11 people have been killed. There are people who will harass me. There are probably some people in here tonight who probably feel strongly enough about abortion who think that because I provide abortions that I forfeited my right to live. But the point is that despite that, I am clear that women need this care and I provide it. And so the question wasn't about whether or not you get compensated for what you do. The question was about what do you do to respond to people in need? And so I was drawing that parallel.
Do you follow through with the women
okay,
afterwards?
Okay, all right, we are going to stop that conversation, and we are going to move it right over here.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for your patience.
Is your mic on?
I don't think so.
Oh, is the mic over here on the right on?
Yeah.
Okay. So you said that you think that abortion is okay on the basis that it is a threat to the woman's life, correct?
Right,
so
right.
My question is, when do we make it okay for a woman to say that I know my emotional capabilities and I know that I may have postpartum depression? As you may know, a lot of women commit suicide due to postpartum depression. So when do we give women the right to say that my emotions are my right to choose that I should put myself before a baby who, you know, what if I were to kill myself after having a baby? So, like, when do we give the right to a woman to choose her own emotions, to have right over her own body and know her limits?
So what you're saying is you support abortion as a means of suicide prevention?
Yes, because that's a woman's life. You're saying that it's okay if it's a threat to a woman's life, and that is a threat to a woman's life. Her emotional well-being can cause a woman to commit suicide, and a woman knows her capabilities of her emotions. So when do we give her that right to say, I know my capabilities, I know that I cannot handle having a baby?
Well, you know, she's producing the threat to her own life, okay? Mm-hmm. And, you know, she's benefiting from that. Mm-hmm. Logically, that doesn't make much sense to me. I mean, you know, it kind of reminds me of the example of someone killing both of his parents and then asking the court to show him mercy because he's an orphan.
Well, you're basically saying this woman, you know, women
all right,
always...
All right. I'm sorry, we're going to cut that one there.
It's invited error.
No, we appreciate that. We are going to move right here to the left.
Hi, Dr. Parker. Thank you so much for coming tonight. I have it written in my notes that you will not do an abortion based on the discrimination of sex and race. Is that correct?
Correct.
So I have a sister with Down syndrome, and I have two quick questions. One being, will you do an abortion based on the knowledge of a disability? And secondly, why will you not do an abortion based on the discrimination of sex and race? Because according to your own terms, it's just an it. It's not a person of value. So why does it matter at that point?
All right, no. all right, we're going to let Dr. Parker respond to that.
Well, you said it's just an it. I never said it was an it.
Okay, I'm sorry. I don't want to misrepresent you. You said it wasn't a person, therefore
it's
lacks value.
It's not a person, correct.
So
I didn't say it wasn't a human
you.
Being. I didn't say it wasn't an it. I didn't say it didn't matter. I didn't say it didn't have moral weight. And what I did say was that a process is going on in a woman's body, falls under the jurisdiction of that woman, and shy of viability when a pregnancy can thrive outside of the womb. I don't question a woman's right to make that decision. With regard to what are the ethical boundaries around in what situations I would provide abortion care, I stated that race-based pregnancy termination, sex selection, and with regard to Down syndrome, your sister, I
sure.
do pregnancy when a woman comes. If there is a fetal indication where there is a problem with the pregnancy and the mother's made the decision to terminate, I don't investigate the reasons my patients terminate. I seek their clarity and I trust their judgment around what's right for them. And that's the question that the young woman was asking about when a woman decides that her mental capacity doesn't allow her. Who is it to say that she should, you know, we'll get you mental help and she knows what she wants. Who are we to say that she doesn't have the capacity to make that decision? She doesn't have to tell me that I think I'll kill myself if I have a baby, but she says, I've weighed my options, I've made my decision, I'm going to end this pregnancy. That's good enough for me and I will end her pregnancy.
You didn't answer my question, but I appreciate the parts you did answer. There's a distinguishment thing?
Distinction?
Distinction, thank you so much, between person and abortion, which you claim is just human, so it's okay, it's killing. I'm just curious to you, why is it okay to kill a fetus or a human, which you're saying is not a person, therefore lacking in maybe value, but it's...
No, I didn't say lacking in value. I said a fetus is... I make the distinction that a fetus is not a person and a woman is a person.
Yes.
And a fetus has moral weight and a woman has moral weight. But it, according to my opponent, a fetus and the pregnancy and a woman that is carrying it, they are equal. And so when their interests compete, my opponent and many people who support him say that they have a right to be more vested in the fruit of a woman's womb than they are in the woman. I disagree.
I think you have many great points. It seems at this point that you agree with Dr. Adams that they're both a people of value and equal. Okay.
All right, we're gonna cut that. And that is it for our questions, our Q&A. Thank you so much to all of you for asking these questions, for being willing to engage in this dialogue. We're so thankful for that. We are going to allow both speakers to do closing statements, and then we will have our final conclusion. We're going to start with Dr. Adams for his five-minute conclusion.
This was awesome. Thank you for being here. Let me just briefly review my syllogism. I came here this evening and I argued that it is wrong to intentionally kill an innocent human being. I supported that with philosophy, arguing that each and every single one of us is valuable not by virtue of the kinds of things that we do, but simply by virtue of the kinds of things we are. We don't have that basic human nature in degrees. You have it or you don't, and every single person in this room has it, and that's the reason why we're equal. And I also supported a minor premise, which said it is wrong to that abortion does, in fact, intentionally kill an innocent human being. I supported that with science. It led me to the conclusion that abortion is therefore wrong. I was very straightforward with you this evening. In contrast, it is my view that my opponent was extremely evasive. And to understand the implications of his evasiveness, I would ask you to just entertain a final thought experiment. I want you to imagine that a man is accused of going to Chicago and taking a gun and killing his brother. He's a suspect, and he is brought in to be questioned by the police. And he says he's never been to Chicago before. And suddenly the police produce receipts suggesting that he has, in fact, been in Chicago. And then he changes his defense, and he says he has never had a gun. Well, the police manage to produce receipts that indicate he's purchased several. So he shifts to a final defense saying, I don't have a brother. And then all of a sudden, the police produce the birth records and show that he does. By the time he gets to his third incompatible explanation, you realize that he absolutely has no defense whatsoever. And that was glaringly obvious when Dr. Parker talked about the issue of what gives humans value. Sometimes he talks about legalism. Sometimes he talks about sentience. Sometimes he talks about general level of development. It seems that he cannot make up his mind. And so that leaves us, I think, with two very fundamental questions. Number one, what is your obligation? If you came here this evening and you were pro-choice and you realized you were making a mistake philosophically, or perhaps you didn't understand the science, it is your obligation to change your mind. I once was pro-choice on the issue of abortion. I was wrong about the science. I changed my mind, and that was not a sign of intellectual weakness. That was a sign of intellectual maturity. But there is a much larger question at stake in this debate, and it is this. Are we all equal? If Dr. Parker is right, and some human beings get to decide whether other human beings qualify for rights of personhood, you can kiss equality goodbye. None of us have it. But if I'm right, and our value is grounded in our basic human nature, and no one can take it away from you, you can walk out of this auditorium and you can speak about equality and it can have meaning because it is grounded. And you understand that my view is grounded in the Declaration of Independence that reminds you that your right to life and your human value don't come from other humans. And that's why other humans cannot take them away. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're going to now turn it over to Dr. Parker for his concluding statement, and then we also have a conclusion from the College Democrats. We have two more things left. The time is yours, Dr. Parker.
First of all, let me thank you for the invitation and your attention. Even if you didn't agree with me, thank you for listening attentively to me. I appreciated the opportunity to participate in this forum with the intent of generating light versus heat. A lot of Dr. Adams, and I've appreciated the the opportunity to be on stage, and it seems like a lot of his coloring of what he wanted you to think about this issue, some of it had to do with what he wanted you to think about me, about what my morals are around being someone who gets paid to provide abortion care, about whether or not I have a reverence and a sanctity for life. He made my argument, I think, the best at the end. He said, if I'm right, human beings are not equal, and it can be determined by one human being whether or not another human being has a right. I'm going to just switch the characters in his narrative. If human beings are equal and that their rights are not derived from other human beings, then the characters in my narrative are men and women are equal, and women are equal in their agency, and therefore, just as men don't have to consult other people about what's going on in their bodies, women, if they are equal, should not have to do the same. And so women shouldn't have to approach or interact with your opinions about whether or not they should have an abortion, whether you be man or woman. The only conscience or the only consultation that a woman should be making around whether or not to continue a pregnancy should be the consultation with her conscience, and that decision is between her and her God if she is of a religious faith, and that God has imbued her with the agency to make that decision. So I go back to the notion, I'm not formally trained in debate, and this is the first debate I've taken because I'm not convinced that this is the best way to disseminate knowledge and to generate understanding, because oftentimes it ends up being like a light beer commercial. Tastes great, less filling, right? And that's only relevant to you if you're a beer drinker. So what I hope tonight is, my goal was never to try and convince you one way or the other. I won't tell you what you have to believe or what you have to think, depending on whether you think I was more compelling or whether you think Dr. Adams was more compelling. What I can tell you is that if you think about this issue, and if you think about the rights that a woman has, if you think about what Abraham Lincoln said when he was asked why he ended slavery, we all know the Civil War was complex for whatever reason, but when he was asked as a white man who was the president why he freed the slaves, you know, he said simply, as I would not be a slave, so I would not be a master. And what he was saying was, I don't know the condition of slavery because I am not a, what we would call then, Negro who was captured and brought to this country and had my labor stolen. Be that as it may, that if slavery stays in place, as a white person, it won't affect me one way or another. But even though I can never be a slave, I know what it means to want for others what I want for myself. And what I want for myself is a life of dignity, self-determination, health, and well-being. And that's what I want for women. And if ending a pregnancy would leave a woman to life, health, and well-being, I will respect her personhood, and I will respect her wishes. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your attention, for your respect. I am now bringing in the College Democrats president to give you a final concluding statement. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Savannah Waters, and I'm president of the UNCW College Democrats. I would like to thank UNCW, Dr. Parker, and Dr. Adams for participating in this civil discussion. Thank you to all the student organizations who made this possible, and thank you for everyone who came out and who's also watching on a live stream. We really love to see the passion that New Hanover County has to offer. Once again, I am with the College Democrats. We meet every Tuesday at 6:00. If you have any interest in what we do and our values, the College Republicans meet every Wednesday at 7 p.m. We both meet in Lutzey Hall. If you would like any more information on what our student organizations do, we will both have tables outside, so you can check us out. Once again, it's great to see civil discussion, especially when we're so exposed to everyone's values on Facebook and et cetera. It's nice to see people talk and have good discussion. So thank you all for coming out. Thank you, UNCW, and thank you, members of the community. We appreciate your support.